be here. I want to thank the organizing committee and Greg particularly for giving me the opportunity to come here in Oregon and present you some of our results that we have from the work that we are doing in Greece, both in the University of Thessaloniki, which is in the north of Greece, and in collaboration with our colleagues in the University of Athens, concerning the environmental and viticultural practice effects on the phenolic composition of grapes. We try to give some emphasis on the impact on the sensory properties of grapes and wines. So far in this Congress, we had some wonderful presentations with very colorful, with beautiful pictures and maps. I'm going to warn you, this won't be one of these. But I will try to keep it as good as I can. So just a little, the structure of the presentation. First of all, we'll give some information, small info on the localization of sensory properties. Some chemistry, I'm not a chemist, but I think it will be helpful for the purpose of the presentation. The evolution pattern during berry development, and then I will focus on the parameters related to environment and to viticultural practice that can affect phenolic composition, structure, and sensory properties. Now, grape secondary metabolites are important quality factors, as we all know, for the taste, the mouthfeel, and the color of the of red and white wines. They practically comprise aroma compounds, the volatile compounds, and of course the mouthfeel compounds and color compounds, which are the phenolics. And most important classes are the anthocyanins and the proanthocyanidins. Now, anthocyanidins in red grapes, they're the monoglucosides of five anthocyanidins: delphinidin, cyanidin, petunidin, peonidin, and malvidin. This is important because malvidin is the most abundant in practically all varieties. But we observed in a research that we did in the north of Greece with three very well-known varieties, Cabernet Sauvignon, Merlot, and Sangiovese, that malvidin can account for nearly 80% of the total pool of anthocyanins in Cabernet Sauvignon and 50% in Sangiovese. On the other hand, Sangiovese contains, practically almost 10% of cyanidin, which is the least frequent of all anthocyanidins. And this has impacts on their sensory, on the response to viticultural practice effects that we will see later on. Now, proanthocyanidins are large molecular weight molecules, which we call also condensed tannins. And the major subunits are epicatechin, epicatechin, epigallocatechin, and epicatechin gallate, which is an ester of epicatechin with gallic acid. They're usually soluble, but when they gain in molecular weight, they can precipitate because of their weight. And therefore, of course, as we all know, the major antioxidants of red wines. Now, tannins derive from both skin sensations, as we all know, but they have differences depending on their origin, in their amount, their length, size, and also their subunit composition, structural composition. So skin tannins skin tannin amount is in most cases lower than in seeds, but also skin tannins are longer, they're more polymerized than those of the seeds. There are other also differences between skin and seed tannins, which are that skin tannins contain prodelphinidins, which is the epigallocatechin. This is important for the sensory properties. And on the other hand, seeds do not contain prodelphinidins, but they contain the gallic ester of epicatechin, which is the epicatechin gallate, which is also involved in some sensory attributes of the seed tannins. Now, astringency is the one parameter, attribute, that is mostly related to tannin structure, composition and structure. And it's positively related to proanthocyanidin concentration, as we see in this figure. But it's also related to proanthocyanidin size. We used to think that the smaller molecules were more astringent, but the recent research has shown that it's the opposite. The bigger molecules are the more astringent than the smaller molecules. Of course, this would mean that skin tannins would be more astringent than seed tannins, but there are other parameters that can modulate this astringency. Big molecules, they can be less soluble, though, so they can precipitate, and also they are bound more powerfully to cell wall material, so they're less easily extracted during maceration. So the bigger the molecules, the less they contribute to the total, to the final sensory attributes of the wines. Other parameters that can modulate astringency that are related mostly to seeds is the degree of galloylation, the percentage of epicatechin gallate, which is the gallic ester of epicatechin, which increases the coarse perception of the red wines. And on the other hand, the presence of prodelphinidins, which is a characteristic of the skin tannins, decreases this sense. So based on this criteria, we can explain the higher astringency of, as we, is a general impression of a higher astringency of the seed tannins. Actually, we had an experiment with a Syrah variety in Greece when we gave seed extracts in a model wine solution to a trained panel of experienced wine assessors, and that showed that seed tannins were actually much more astringent in when perceived in sensory analysis than the skin tannins, and this largely confirms what we believe in literature. Now, some few things about the revolution during berry ripening. Both tannins and anthocyanins derive from branch pathways of the general phenylpropanoid pathway of the flavonoids. And anthocyanin accumulation starts at veraison. Normally it increases until ripening, but in many cases, many authors have observed, like we did with Syrah variety in Greece, that the maximum concentration results some days after veraison. We found 18 to 24 days after veraison with a decline after that. This is something that has been observed in many other cases and that winemakers should take into account when they want to correctly choose the harvest time to increase and maximize wine color. Now, proanthocyanidins by synthesis starts earlier after anthesis and reaches a maximum at veraison or shortly after veraison. And their data is more scarce, and we know most, in most cases they show that their pattern during berry ripening, it's either a stable constant, do not change much, or a decline, as we observed in Syrah variety in an experiment we did in the north of Greece, both in 2 years of the study, 2011 and 2012, we had a steady decline, both skins and seeds. About the evolution, not of the amount of anthocyanins and proanthocyanidins, but their structural properties, which are important for the sensory parameters. So we found out that for Syrah variety, in the same experiment, the polymerization of the seed decreases slightly during berry ripening, whereas the opposite happens for skin polymerization, which means that the seed molecules become smaller and skin molecules become larger during berry ripening. Now, what happens with the environmental factors affecting phenolic composition? First of all, we can name a large number of site parameters like those that we had in the few days, in the few past days. And we see that many parameters of the landscape, like the slope, the altitude, of course, the soil, can influence the phenolic composition, especially the anthocyanin composition. And we see that anthocyanins are very well spatially structured in a vineyard. And this generally follows the type of soil, especially soil depth, or soil water content or soil nutrient content. And usually the higher levels of anthocyanins are found in places where soils have confer lower vigor and yield to the wine, so that soils with lower depth and lower water uptake or nutrient uptake. In this experiment that we did in central Greece with the variety Agiorgitic, one of our best grape, red wine grape varieties, we found that in a soil where its variability was mainly slope driven, with a more deep soil in the bottom of the hill, the higher levels of anthocyanins were, of course, found in the middle and upper part, but the rank order was not always the same among vintages depending on the different weather conditions. Of course, the environmental parameter most studied in literature is light incidence on grapes, and generally it has been found that in most cases high light incidence increases anthocyanins in grapes, and this is because most of the genes related to the specific biosynthetic anthocyanin genes are upregulated when grapes are exposed to direct sunlight. However, a major concern in warm countries is the interaction between light and temperature. And in a very good work that possibly most of us know here from Bergqvist et al. Back in 2001, he saw that in the north-facing side of the rows, anthocyanins increase linearly with light incidence on grapes, whereas on the south side, where the grapes were exposed to higher temperatures, the anthocyanins started to decrease after light intensity exceeded a certain level. The interesting thing that was cooling restored the high levels of anthocyanins on the more exposed grapes. Now, we suggested in the work that I presented to you before with the three varieties that this response to the combined effects of temperature and light incidence can be also cultivar-driven, cultivar-dependent. So we found out that in the very hot conditions of Greece where temperatures and grape temperatures can sometimes exceed 35 or 40 degrees during midday, with varieties like Cabernet Sauvignon and Merlot, even in the fully defoliated grapes, had the higher levels of anthocyanin despite the high temperatures, whereas this did not happen with San Giovese. And we tried to explain this here. We tried to explain this by the amount of malvidin in the total pool of anthocyanins. These two varieties, as I said before, contain more and more malvidin in the total pool of anthocyanins, and we know that malvidin is a highly acylated anthocyanin, and methoxylation and acylation increases the thermal stability of anthocyanins. So this can possibly explain the fact that in Sangiovese, which is a less dominated variety by malvidin, results were not the same. So regarding the effects of light exposure on the skin and seed proanthocyanidins, for the skins, although results are much less recent, are more scarce compared to anthocyanidins, we see practically the same positive impact on skin proanthocyanidins in the grapes exposed to light, whereas in our conditions for the same experiment, we found out that the opposite happens with the flavanol monomers, which are the main flavonoids, the main tannins that we have in the seeds. Happened the exact opposite. That means that the non-exposed grapes, the shaded grapes, had the higher levels of monomers, flavanol monomers, which is monomeric and oligomeric tannins in the seeds, which means that we can say that generally light incidence on grapes can have an overall positive effect on the phenolic ripeness, on the phenolic maturity of grapes, increasing skin flavonoids and decreasing the very more astringent seed flavonoids. Now, coming to vineyard factors, a number of factors have been studied in literature, like rootstocks, training systems, nutrition, irrigation, summer pruning techniques. For summer pruning techniques, this mainly concerns the selective leaf removal to influence and moderate the light exposure of the grapes. So I've already talked about that, so I won't insist anymore. So I will present to you some of our results about rootstocks, training systems, and of course I will insist a little bit more in the end about irrigation. Now, about rootstocks, we did an experiment involving two rootstocks of different vigor, SO4 and 1103 Paulsen, which are more drought-resistant rootstock compared to a rootstock which is less drought-resistant, and we see that they had completely different vigor, as we see from the evolution during the season of the leaf area index. So we found out that, again, for seed flavanols, monomers and oligomers, which are the more astringent and bitter tannins, we found that on the SO4 rootstock, Cabernet vines gave lower numbers of seed flavanols, whereas they were higher in the 1103 Paulsen, and we tried to explain that by the level of exposure of the grapes to the sun, as I said before, and actually we had very good correlations between the flavanol monomers and tannins and total phenolics with the leaf area index. So possibly the lower numbers in the SO4 can be explained by the restriction of vine growth, vegetative growth, which also increased the light incidence on grapes. Now, regarding trellis system, training system, we did an experiment with another Greek variety, the Xenomorph variety, which dominates the north of Greece, our best, most noble red variety, with three training systems, the Lyre or the Lyre, I don't know how we call it, and two classic VSP systems, the double Roya cordon and the single Guillot. And we found out that first for the anthocyanins, all anthocyanin levels were increased in the grapes of the Lyre system, possibly because of the divided system and because of the light penetration within the canopy was higher. On the contrary, we had higher levels of tannins, both in skins and seeds, in Roya cordon, and for the skins, and in Guillot single cordon for the single Guillot for the seeds. And again, the degree of polymerization was higher in the Roya grapes. So for Xenomavro, which actually is a variety with low color and very thin and aggressive tannins, the Lyre could have a particular advantage by increasing calorie, inducing the phenolic content of grapes. Now about irrigation, it's certainly the most influential, the single most important and controllable factor, especially under semi-arid conditions. And we know that for many studies so far, that flavonoids in skins, both anthocyanins and proanthocyanins, increase in the vines that are exposed to a mild or moderate water deficit. And this was exactly the result that we had in our own study involving the Syrah variety. In 2011, we see the results of anthocyanins and the results of tannins with the higher levels in the non-irrigated ones with similar results in 2012 vintage. Now, this has been explained by many, given many explanations about the better carbon balance, the better light exposure of the grapes, or the smaller berry size. But actually, we have many studies on the molecular level, like this one that we did in the same experiment, showing that seven genes encoding enzymes, important enzymes of the phenylpropanoid biosynthetic pathway, and one transcriptional factor here from the green color, we can say that from this heat map that were more expressed, more triggered earlier in the season in the water deficit treatment, the non-irrigated treatment, compared to the fully irrigated treatment. Now, the study of irrigation on the other compounds, like the seed compounds, the results are more scarce. So here, we did in the same experiment with the two rootstocks in Cabernet Sauvignon variety. We found out that irrigation increased the levels, again, like in the shaded grapes. Irrigation increased the levels of seed flavanols, possibly again because of the modification of the light environment and the more shade that had the grapes of non-fully irrigated vines. Now we, in a recent work that is not, it's published, was submitted for publication, but is still not published. We tried to find a little bit more about the influence of irrigation on the structural properties, which are important for the sensory attributes of the grapes and wines. And what we found out here is that for the seed, we found a slight declining pattern. And as we said, non-irrigated vines had higher polymerization degree, but this was more clear for the skin tannins, which showed higher levels of higher size, average size of molecules in the polymers in the non-irrigated vines. Unfortunately, we didn't have any important results for the galloylation degree or the subunit composition. It was not different, significantly different among treatments. And to finish, I will show you what was the result about from the sensory evaluation of skin and seed extracts from the same panel of experienced and trained wine assessors. And it showed that especially for the seeds, the non-irrigated, the extracts from the non-irrigated vines had lower perception of astringency in the seeds, whereas the same but not very significant effect was observed for the skins, which also confirms that overall irrigation is mostly positive for the phenolic quality, especially the tannin quality of the grapes and wines. So to finish my presentation, considerable research has been done so far about the effect of environmental and viticultural factors, especially anthocyanins, but fewer research has been done for tannins and polymeric molecules, and mostly for their structural and sensory properties, which has to be addressed more in the future. Irrigation, of course, and microclimate modification has been shown to be the most important factors in affecting phenolic composition and structure, but there are other cultivar and environmental factors like rootstocks, orientation, training systems, nutrition, that have to be studied in the future. Before closing, I'm going to thank all my collaborators, both in Thessaloniki and in Athens, and of course I want to thank you for your attention.